Hello and welcome to this presentation I'm excited about. It's been a while I wanted to make such a presentation. And the topic is Sri T Krishnamacharya and the yoga that he taught. And the yoga that he learned, what he learned in his formative years. It's a subject I'm very passionate about, so I'm happy to be presenting this topic for you today. So I was thinking that we would start Shri Krishna Vagishayatishvarabhyam Samprapta Chakran Kanabhashya Saram Shri Nut Narangendra Yatau Samarpitasvam Shri Krishna Marian Gurvariyamide Virodhe Kartike Mase Shatatara Kritodayam Yoga Charyan Krishna Mariam Guruvaryamaham bhaje Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Om. All right, so thanks for tuning in. And since this topic requires going through a bit of the biography on the Acharya, the teacher, I suggest that you also, if you'd like, get a hold of the what's it called, this biography that A.G. Mohan published with his son Ganesh Mohan. So this is Krishnamacharya, his life and teachings. It's a very good book to have. Among other books that we'll talk about in the course of time. So let me just go back to the screen share. So, now, as I was saying, there's this document I put together, which was just compiling some information from a documentary that was in 1988, taking place during the time of Krishnamacharya's 100th birthday celebrations. The documentary is called 100 Years of Beatitude. It was researched and commentary by Sarah Dars and the images by Jean-Francois Dars. So there's just some stuff that I'd like to use as a jumping off point in looking at the story of Sri Tirumalai Krishnamacharya. So the professor was initially introduced to the subject of yoga through his father, who was his first acharya, his first teacher. But then unfortunately Krishnamacharya's father died not long after his initiation into the subject and his Vedic studies. He studied with his father for a short time before his father unfortunately had passed away. But in any case, there's documents, archival documents that is in the possession of the Deshikachar family, in which there's the possession of a very old edition of a small Yoga Sutra book that was Krishnamacharya's father's. And Yoga Sutra was transmitted to a young Krishnamacharya as such, as was some of the Vedic studies. Krishnamacharya's family was coming from the Krishna Yajurveda branch, and so he was exposed to some Upanishads as part of the Krishna Yajurveda that is directly relevant to the study of the subject of yoga, such as the Katha Upanishad and the Sritattvanidhi Upanishad, very relevant Upanishads. So a young Krishnamacharya was introduced to these Upanishads dealing with yoga at an early age, which of course inspired him to seek out further learning in the subject of yoga. So, as I said, he was brought up by his father, who was his first acharya, until he was 16 years old, according to some presentations of his biography. There's some questions regarding the chronology, exactly when certain things took place, but I won't spend too much time scrutinizing these details. The basic information is correct, is what I want to say. If there was some information that was either intentionally embellished or the facts got distorted over time because of just forgetting exact dates, and then the story began being told as according to certain dates that maybe weren't the original dates, that's a different story, but the basic elements remain as fact, let's say. That a young Krishnamacharya, of course, was taught by his father, and then he also enrolled in the studies at the Mysore Parikala Mutt. So there was a long tradition of his family learning at this institution, and his grandfather was a pretty established acharya at this institution, and Krishnamacharya proceeded to study there, the Vedic studies in Sanskrit. So he became a disciple of various acharyas. If I quote from the documentary, the 1988 documentary that I mentioned, from this Mysore Institute of Philosophy, and following Hindu tradition, he revered them as representatives on earth of God, the primeval guru. It says here, even including a classmate of Krishnamacharya's, who he considered also someone he looked up to. So if we look at the main acharyas that he was looking up to from the Parikala Mutt in his formative years in Mysore, there's Sri Vagisha Brahma Tantra Parikala Swami, one of Krishnamacharya's preceptors. So of course, if we go to the this initial chant that we looked at, we see that Krishnamacharya was taught by Sri Krishna Brahma Tantra Parikala Swami. He was the head of the Sri Brahma Tantra Parikala Mutt from 1877 until his death in 1912. This document here that we're looking at is courtesy of Paul Harvey and his website, who was a pupil of Sri TKV Deshikachar, one of the sons of Sri T Krishnamacharya. So then we also have mention of Sri Krishna Brahma Tantra Parikala Swami, another teacher of Krishnamacharya's. So that's the first one, Sri Krishna Brahma Tantra Parikala Swami, whereas this one was Sri Vagisha Brahma Tantra Parikala Swami. Sorry, I had the two reversed. He was the successor, rather, to Sri Krishna, and was head of the Mutt from 1912 until his death in 1925. So Krishnamacharya was honoring these two individuals. And as far as the classmate of Sri Krishnamacharya is mentioned, it was Sri Ranganatha Brahmatantra Parikala Swami, born in 1884. So he's just a little older than Krishnamacharya, who is said to have been born in 1888. Who was a classmate of Sri Krishnamacharya at the Mysore Parikala Mutt. and was the successor to Sri Vagisha Brahmatantra Parakala Swami in 1925 until his death in 1967. So Krishnamacharya was honoring these heads of the institution, the Mysore Parakala Mutt. And it says in this prayer, you can see this prayer is actually honoring Krishnamacharya's teachers more so than honoring Krishnamacharya himself. Of course, by honoring his teachers, you're honoring him and going forward from there. So from the older Sri Krishna Brahmatantra Parakala Swami, he was taught, Krishnamacharya was taught mantra and initiated into Chakrankanam, which is the ritual of prostrating and receiving Shankha, right side, and Chakra, left side, on the shoulders. So these are traditional ritual procedures. And then as far as from Sri Vagisha Ramatantra Parakala Swami, Krishnamacharya learned from him the essence of Sri Bhashyam. So that's Vedanta, the philosophy of Vedanta. And from Sri Ranganatha Brahmatantra Parakala Swami. So Sri Rangendra, who initiated Krishnamacharya into Bharanyasam, to place at the Lord's feet, or how to surrender to God. And then it lists the year of Krishnamacharya's death, at least according to this. Born in the year of Virodha, which is 1888, during the month of Kritika, November, under the star Shatatara, this teacher of yoga, Guru Krishnamacharya, I salute. So that's the last part. Virodhe kartike mase shatatara kritodayam yogacharyan krishnamaryam guruvaryam aham bhaje. So we salute the Acharya Krishnamacharya, who learned from the preceding mentioned teachers. In any case, so moving forward, the documentary goes on to say that around 1915, Krishnamacharya traveled to Benares, otherwise known as Varanasi, and Calcutta, where he learned Hindi, Bengali, Urdu, and English. He was also already fluent in Telugu, his mother tongue, Kannada, and Sanskrit. The Sanskrita. He also studied grammar, Ayurvedic medicine, music, astrology, and the six philosophical systems of India, which later earned him diplomas from the universities of Patna, Calcutta, Benares, etc., Mysore, and Allahabad. But he spent a particular time in Varanasi, in any case, studying at the Hindu university there. So he's said to have diplomas in the six philosophical systems. What are the six philosophical systems? Well, yoga, the classical subject of yoga, is among these six orthodox systems that are based on the authority of the Vedas. It's called Astika Darshana. So yoga is one such darshana of the six. There's an older philosophy called Sankhya, which yoga is based on. And both of these are tradition of liberation. They seek out liberation. The other tradition that seeks out liberation but has a slightly different perspective is Vedanta. So the other three darshanas are Nyaya, it's a school of logic, Vaisheshika, which is metaphysics. Then we have Mimamsa, which is a precursor to Vedanta. Mimamsa is dealing more with ritual rules, and Vedanta is more philosophical in nature, dealing with ultimate reality and seeking out liberation, not necessarily just accumulating good karma as opposed to bad karma, but rather end the cycle of karma altogether. In fact, Sankhya, Yoga, and Vedanta, this is their concern, ending the cycle of rebirth and become completely liberated. So you can see Krishnamacharya was very studious. He earned six diplomas in these six orthodox philosophical schools. He personally was a Vedantin, and his family tradition, not only would I specify that they're a Krishna Yajurveda branch, one of the books of the Vedas, but he was also coming from a specific perspective, philosophical perspective of Vedanta, as according to his family tradition, which was Vishishtadvaita Vedanta. So it's qualified non-dual Vedanta. Vedanta also, this means Veda Anta, so it's the end of the Vedas. So in no small part, according to the philosophical perspectives found in the Upanishads themselves, which are chronologically late into the Vedic period. The orthodox traditions are based on the authority of the Vedas, so they come somewhat after. So anyways, it is here where he is said to have also studied and became proficient in the science of Ayurveda, which is relevant to his work as a yoga healer, yoga therapist. But to go further on his family background, he's coming from Vishishtadvaita Vedanta, who the main acharya as part of that philosophy, the first acharya is, of course, Sri Ramanuja. He was the teacher that was going against the other philosophical schools in debate, according to the Advaita of Shankaracharya and the Dvaita of Madhvacharya. So there was Ramanujacharya, who was the first precept of Vishishtadvaita Vedanta, qualified non-dualism. So this is obviously a slightly different perspective than what is seen in yoga and Sankhya. They're talking about a particular view of reality that is dual in nature, whereas non-dual Vedanta is framing the ultimate as one, as this God Brahma, which can be personified as one of the other deities of the triad. So in Krishnamacharya's family, they were Vishnu worshipping, so they were Vaishnavite, so they saw the ultimate reality as this one deity, this one God as Lord Vishnu. So Ramanujacharya was a student of a teacher before him called Yamunacharya. So this is again where we continue to trace the lineage back. Ramanujacharya popularized Vishishtadvaita, but who he learned from was Yamunacharya, who was the grandson of a Vaishnavite saint of the ninth century Common Era by the name of Sri Nathamuni. And according to the mythology around Krishnamacharya, Nathamuni is said to be a blood relative of Krishnamacharya all the way down the line. Of course, I'm not sure if there's a way to verify the blood relation, but this is what is said. In any case, it's totally plausible to understand that Krishnamacharya is coming, at least from the philosophical perspective, of Ramanujacharya, coming from Yamanacharya, and subsequently coming from his grandfather, Nathamuni. So Nathamuni, like I said, was a 9th century Vaishnavite saint. And I'd like to bring up at this point that a young Krishnamacharya was so eager to learn that he traveled to a temple in the region of the Alwars. This is where Nathamuni is said to have resided. He was a disciple of Namalvar, and Krishnamacharya wanted to know about his long-lost ancestor, Nathamuni. He wanted to learn the secret yoga that Nathamuni taught. There's a story that goes like this. He went to this particular temple and was in search of the teachings of Nathamuni on yoga. Now, what is said to have happened was he was on temple grounds and fell into a trance state and came back with a vision of having been received a text by the name of Yoga Rahasya, which he attributes to his long-lost ancestor, Nathamuni. So this is the story that he told his pupils. But it's broadly accepted among such pupils, like my teacher Srivatsa Ramaswami or his colleague A.G. Mohan. It's well accepted with these acharyas that Krishnamacharya composed this text called the Yoga Rahasya, if not perhaps loosely based on his family tradition, perhaps received under mysterious circumstances in this samadhi state. So it's difficult, we can't of course definitively say this is a 9th century work by the Vaishnavite saint Sri Nathamuni, because no such text was ever found until Krishnamacharya brought it to light. So we could loosely say it's a Krishnamacharya work, or at least it's a compilation of what he may have received in such a vision. He even says as much that he may have left certain things out, that he might have forgotten based on the fallibility of his memory in terms of going through such a mysterious experience. So now I'd like to bring your attention to this publication, the Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, which was founded in 1976 by the professor's son, T.K.V. Deshikachar, published one such translation. It's Deshikachar's translation of the Yoga Rahasya that Krishnamacharya transmitted. So it's labeled here as Nathamuni's Yoga Rahasya, translated by T.K.V. Deshikachar. But like I said, this is a text that, as far as Ramaswami and Mohan are concerned, it's can be broadly accepted as a Krishnamacharya work, composition, that he attributes to his ancestor Nathamuni. This has caused a bit of a stir with the academics, even going so far to sort of suggest Krishnamacharya is some kind of a liar. But if you look at his close disciples who stayed with him for 20, 30 years, Ramaswami and Mohan, they have absolutely no conflict calling this a work by Krishnamacharya, which is in agreement with these Western academics that have pointed to this and with a lot of questions and their hands thrown up in the air. So as we can say, it's a work that's perhaps broadly accepted to be a composition by none other than Krishnamacharya himself that he attributes to his ancestor, that he says he received under mysterious circumstances in this samadhi state when he was on a pilgrimage to this particular temple. So this is the text. It's available to, you can go to Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram website, purchase a copy. It's available. So I recommend, if you're interested in this, to do that, to seek out this book and study it for yourself. And this is the way the document looks. This is a scan of the book. So again, I recommend you purchase a copy for the sake of sharing on screen. Here's a scan of it. And to point to one such Western academic that has brought into question the story of Krishnamacharya's studies and his what he transmitted as far as the Yoga Rahasya goes. There's this Western academic, David Gordon White, which is non-apologetic in his views of Krishnamacharya and the hagiography of his life story. He points to the fact that it's difficult to say the published biographies of Krishnamacharya are entirely accurate, if not they're somewhat mythologizing the man. But I would say again that the basic facts are true. Krishnamacharya was raised by his father and was initiated by his father in the study of Vedas and in the subject of yoga. There's evidence, obviously, that he studied at the Parikala Math, which was a part of his family tradition to go study there with those teachers mentioned. And then there's supposed to be evidence that he did travel to Varanasi to attain diplomas in these six orthodox philosophical schools. So he was a Vedantin, particularly of the Vishishtadvaita branch, but he was interested in learning about Sankhya and Yoga, which are contending schools with the Vedantin line. And Vedanta also has those three branches, there's main branches of Advaita, Dvaita, and then Vishishtadvaita. So Krishnamacharya was coming from that particular branch and Vedanta at that, but he was not, still open to learning Sankhya philosophy and yoga, which he feels strengthened his understanding of his overall perspective. And I'll also say that he taught students individually and according to their beliefs. So he was not imposing his personal belief onto his students. Okay. He was not imposing students become Vaishnavite. He was teaching atheist students. He had some Western students in the 60s. You know, so he was not imposing anything. He had personal views that were of a Vishishtadvaita Vedantin slant or leaning. But he was teaching the text, the Yoga Sutra of Patanjali. He was teaching the Sankhya Karika of Ishwar Krishna, which are ultimately philosophies that are dualist in nature, that contends with the Vedantin view. So he was teaching these texts going word by word. he had no conflict, and he was able to go through these things because he's an academic himself. He was a pundit, a scholar, and very well read in that regard, with all these diplomas, like we said. So David Gordon White, he calls into question a lot in the story of Krishnamacharya, which I take anyways, there's this chapter in this book, Strange Case of Krishnamacharya. So he calls into question the story of the Yoga Rahasya, of course. But again, so here he's framing Krishnamacharya out to be a liar. But again, if you look at Krishnamacharya's own pupils that stayed with him for 20, 30 years in A.G. Mohan and Srivatsa Ramaswami, they have absolutely no conflict in stating the Yoga Rahasya is broadly accepted as a work by Krishnamacharya himself. And they acknowledge that there's a story that goes along with this. Of course, India is replete with storytelling. It's part of the tradition, and it's a different perspective than Westerners are perhaps familiar with or comfortable with in accepting. So it's just a different way of coming at these things. And if his own Indian students, Mohan and Ramaswami, are accepting that this is a Krishnamacharya work, even though Krishnamacharya would tell them that he received this from Nathamuni, they still broadly accept this as a work by Krishnamacharya, again, if not influenced by what he may have received in this Samadhi state, at which he attributes to in particular, that sage Nathamuni, who is said to be in his family lineage. There's been some question about the... I'm not a Sanskritist, so I cannot speak to this, but there's been question about the Sanskrit verses of the Yoga Rahasya, that they're not ancient Sanskrit grammar, it's more modern. And of course, like I said, this is Krishnamacharya's transmission of the text. So he's noting down what he says he was transmitted himself through that mysterious Samadhi state. So it's in his writing in Sanskrit. It's a Sanskrit work. So anyways, that's how we can reconcile it. It's perhaps Krishnamacharya's notes based on his family lineage. So it's a very humble way of looking at it anyways. So let me go back to the Yoga Rahasya document here. He defers to his teacher, his father's father, his family's tradition, lineage tradition, which goes back and back and back all the way to Ramanujacharya, of course, Yamanacharya, and Sri Nathamuni. So he is bowing in humility to these great acharyas, to the great Vaishnavite saints of the 9th century. And as so, he attributes this vision to this Vaishnavite saint who he was deliberately seeking out in this pilgrimage. So that's how it goes. Also, the fact of receiving such a transmission in a mysterious Samadhi state. Einstein himself spoke of receiving answers to questions, formulas, while in a state of concentration or meditation. So even a scientist can speak of such a mysterious state that is not scientifically quantifiable. So who are we to question that this is not the case with Krishnamacharya? And of course, this is a tradition of in India. The Vedas themselves are said to be received by the Vedic rishis while they themselves were in a state of meditation upon the Lord. So as such, the Vedas are considered very sacred. They're considered the words of God. The Vedic mantras are considered the words of God. They're to be treated very sacredly. So there's a tradition of this kind of experience in ancient India, and Nathamuni himself is said to have been transmitted. He received poems from his deceased teacher, Namalvar. Anyway, this is all found here, Sri Namalvar, the story. So this book is really honoring Krishnamacharya's family line and the 9th century Vaishnavite saint Nathamuni. And it's dealing with the subject of yoga practice. So like I said, Krishnamacharya was taught, as through his father, the instruction in yoga, his transmission in yoga. So in a way, we're sitting on the shoulders of giants. So this is a way that Krishnamacharya was transmitting this text. He considers he was sitting on the shoulders of giants with knowledge that was passed on from generation to generation, and so on and so forth. And there's also the thing about sometimes you hear various things in a lesson with one's teacher, and certain things stick out, and other things were said very much in passing, but they're very packed full of potent thoughts for reflection. But maybe it went in passing to the young student. Only later, when in a state of concentration, might something that was heard in lesson finally actually come up and become a subject for deeper contemplation. Having a realization of what the teacher said, where they were coming from, after the fact. So anyways, there's all these ways of trying to understand where Krishnamacharya was coming from. And I am not one to dismiss outright the story, although it's helpful to consider the nuance that Krishnamacharya was coming from, as people like A.G. Mohan and Ramaswami talk about. They don't frame Krishnamacharya as being this liar. He was someone who was transmitting something he received under mysterious circumstances that he attributes to his long-lost ancestor. So let us accept this story. So there's some background. If you get the book, you'll see into the pilgrimage, and also in terms of the Alwars, the Tamil Vaishnavite saints, where Nathamuni himself was coming from. The tradition can be considered sampradaya. Sampradaya is another word for tradition. So this is the story of the Yoga Rahasya that Krishnamacharya received. It's a very interesting text. Anyways, some other notes that I might add. So this book is not so popular with his earliest pupils. I know I'm jumping chronologically to the after his formative years, when he's teaching in Mysore, his early pupils. He wasn't, his early pupils were young, so there's that. I'll get to that when I get there chronologically. But it's more so emphasized from his later pupils, from his Chennai period, when he relocated to Madras. So that would be, namely, of course, his son TKV Deshikachar, A.G. Mohan, Srivatsa Ramaswami. These pupils teach this. not so much in the Ashtanga Vinyasa school or BKS Iyengar's school of Iyengar Yoga. They don't talk so much about it. So it's more the students from the Chennai period that were really transmitted this text. Again, if I speak about Pattabhi Joyce in terms of the Ashtanga Vinyasa lineage and BKS Iyengar, Iyengar himself admits that he studied with Krishnamacharya for a short period before Krishnamacharya told him to go teach in Pune. So, and he was, the 2 years that he learned under Krishnamacharya was in Iyengar's teenage years. So he was taught as a teenager. Of course, there was no time to go into deep philosophical subjects, and Iyengar was quite sickly when he first started. So his main concern at first was to gain bodily health. And then there were the classes that Krishnamacharya was teaching at the Mysore Palace, where he was employed, which is no small feat to be employed by the king of Mysore of the time. Absolutely no small feat. He was very well regarded as a yoga acharya, not just in the physical practice, but someone very, very knowledgeable and studied in the shastras, the texts, the scriptures. He was through and through yogacharya, pandita, yoga scholar. So he was hired as such at the Mysore Palace, where he taught, and Pattabhi Joyce was a student among these young teenagers at the at this Mysore Palace, where they had the yoga classes at the shala. And so Pattabhi Joyce was learning a very rigorous practice as a teenager, similar to what Iyengar eventually was learning once he began to overcome his health difficulties. So they were teenagers learning a particular practice, whereas once Krishnamacharya relocated to Madras, he was teaching Ramaswami also as a teenager, but Ramaswami stayed with him until he was late 40s. Mohan came to him in his, came to Krishnamacharya when Mohan was in his 20s and stayed for 18 years. Deshikachara stayed for 20, 30 years. So they stayed for a long time, and they got to get more from Krishnamacharya. He wasn't just teaching physical practice like he would for teenagers. He was getting into that and further, getting into the nitty-gritty of why we practice and what the shastras say. Anyways, you get into some of this material with this Yoga Rahasya and some of the insights, we might say, from Krishnamacharya and his family lineage. So this text speaks about bhakti or devotion. It speaks about adapting yoga according to one's needs, the yoga practice according to different stages of life, okay, which is a very important point, and it actually highlights why Krishnamacharya didn't teach BKS Iyengar something more than just a physical practice, because he had this perspective of a three stages of life, at the very least three stages, which is a traditional way of looking at one's life stages in India. Of course, there was always these renunciants that retired to the forest even early on in their life, but most people were living in the world, living as householders, and Krishnamacharya very much was coming from this lineage tradition, coming from householder yogis, and yogis that were scholar practitioners, very well versed in the shastras, the scriptures, as well as practicing So not just book knowledge, but understanding from a practical perspective. So it's a different perspective that embraces this three stages of life model, where the early stage is when it's more about strength and growth and learning a physical practice as such that supports that. Whereas the second stage of life is for the householder, dispensing with their worldly responsibilities, and the priority at this point is to maintain a certain baseline health. It's more health oriented, so it's less practicing very fantastic asanas or physical postures, but more emphasizing healthful procedures of pranayama and certain hatha mudras. And in the third stage of life, when someone has retired from their worldly duties, they can focus more and more time to meditation itself and contemplating the deeper meaning found in the shastras. Not to say that the young individual, the young student, isn't to meditate at all or isn't to be exposed to the Vedas, because that's not true in India. The young students are exposed to the Vedas, they chant the Vedas, the Upanishads, and they are initiated into, as children of 7 years old, they are initiated into a ritual procedure of prayer and mantra recitation, japa. So it's in the culture that people are initiated within their family to do this sort of ritual prayer and mantra recitation. So it was also beyond the scope of Krishnamacharya's employee at the Mysore Palace to get into teaching young students anyways, anything beyond their capabilities of comprehension, right? So of course the students themselves were initiated into ritual prayer as part of their family line. This is outside of Krishnamacharya's business. And also, as such, they were learning Vedas according to their family branch. So, anyways, this is also to counter David Gordon White in terms of suggesting Krishnamacharya didn't get to philosophy himself until later. That's not the case. This is judging purely by the output of BKS Iyengar and Pattabhi Joyce in terms of their teaching a very rigorous and physical practice with not much information to go into Shastra study. Of course, like I said, what they are transmitting is what they learned as teenagers, and adapting on that, working with that, Iyengar adapted and evolved his understanding from that base. And Pattabhi Joyce was teaching a very rigorous set of postures that he was learning as a teenager, as a sort of a drill practice, set order of asanas. So that's what he transmitted, but that's not the only way Krishnamacharya was teaching in Mysore. He was teaching other people like Indra Devi during this period in Mysore, and he didn't teach Indra Devi the strict, rigorous practice like seen in Pattabhi Joy's presentation of Ashtanga Vinyasa. He was teaching Indra Devi something different, which can be compared to some elements you see in Deshikacharya's teachings, you know, and Ramaswamy's teachings, you know, something that is more slow, fewer asanas, more breath-centered. Anyways, let me take a step back. So we were talking about Krishnamacharya's formative years. He learned at the Mysore Parakalamat, then he traveled to Varanasi, among other cities, where he was seeking out academic learning and diplomas in the six philosophical schools. He learned Ayurveda and other such subjects. But then he wanted to learn more about yoga, and he wanted to learn from a yoga practitioner. So this is another story that is contested among the Western academics. If we go back to David Gordon White, so not only the story about Yoga Rahasya is put into question, even the story of Krishnamacharya going to a teacher afterward. So the story goes that Krishnamacharya, after his studies in Varanasi, he proceeded to seek out a particular teacher that was brought to his attention that lives in the foothills of the Himalayas at Mount Kailash. This is in Tibet. So the story goes that Krishnamacharya traveled as far north as Tibet, although there's some question, maybe it was in fact Nepal. The teacher's name is Ramamohan Brahmachari. So David Gordon White calls into question whether Krishnamacharya truly traveled as far as the Himalayas, as far as Tibet or Nepal, wherever that might have been. We don't know. But we just have been given this name, Ramamohan Brahmachari, as the alleged teacher that Krishnamacharya learned from. I have no reason to doubt that Krishnamacharya learned from a teacher after his studies in Varanasi. And the name that he gives is Sri Ramamohan Brahmachari. So I have no reason to doubt that he learned from such an individual. Where he was located, I don't know. The story goes that he traveled north. How far north? I don't know. The mythology around Krishnamacharya says he traveled to Mount Kailash in Tibet, the foothills of the Himalayas. But of course, we don't know if that's true, if it's an embellishment of the story. The story also goes that he stayed with this teacher for 7 years before he was instructed by his teacher, Sri Ramamohan Brahmachari, who was a householder himself, who had a family, and they were living in a cave, supposedly. Krishnamacharya's teacher, Sri Ramamohan Brahmachari, instructed this young Krishnamacharya, after 7 years of study, to go back to Mysore and find a wife, start a family, and also teach yoga to householders. That was Krishnamacharya's mission upon completing his studies under his teacher, Ramamohan Brahmachari. For some reason, the Western academics call into question this whole part of his biography, this whole part of his story. But Krishnamacharya had to have learned from someone, as what he ended up presenting later on was quite a developed system. It didn't come out of nowhere. And he was not employed by the king of Mysore for being a charlatan that was making stories up. He was certainly coming from something. And it was something very strong. He was very proficient. And of course, Krishnamacharya had contemporaries like Swami Kuvalayananda, who learned from a teacher a Bengali teacher. Kuvalayananda eventually settled in Pune, I believe, but his teacher was in Bengali. He was Bengalese. So Swami Kuvalayananda, his teacher, I forget his name, not much more than Krishnamacharya's teacher is known about Kuvalayananda's teacher. Although this, with the exception that Kuvalayananda's teacher, there's surviving photographs, at least a couple of photographs of that teacher, who would have been the same generation as Krishnamacharya's teacher, Ramamohan Brahmachari. Unfortunately, this is not the case for Ramamohan Brahmachari. There's no photographs that we have of this particular teacher. So this is maybe one of the other reasons why some of the Western academics call into question if Krishnamacharya really learned from such an individual. He must have learned from somebody, you know? So, and the name that we have been given is Ramamohan Brahmachari. So why should we doubt that he learned from such an individual? That's my point. Whether he traveled as far north as Tibet is another story. Anyways, so that's another point of contention that the Western academics tend to speak on. So going back to this document I have here, so we have Krishnamacharya's early studies with his father, then at the Mysore Parikala Math, and then traveling to Varanasi, studying at the Banaras Hindu University, and where he received diplomas in the six orthodox philosophical systems, as well as in other subjects such as the Sanskrita grammar, in the science of Ayurveda, and also music, astrology, etc. So afterward, it was, like I said, brought to his attention by one of his teachers in Varanasi, as Krishnamacharya was inquiring about a Yogacharya practitioner that he can learn from. So he was instructed to go to Mount Kailash, as the story goes. So here, continuing with what's said in this documentary, to further perfect his knowledge, he went up to the Himalayas to join a wise old man who lived in a cave more than 12,000 feet up. He finally reached Mount Kailash in Tibet, which is where Shiva lives, according to the mythology of the deities. And this point, Mount Kailash, is apparently considered as the world's axis, according to this documentarian. Anyways, here at the source of the Indus, the Ganges, and the Brahmaputra, the pilgrims come to circle repeatedly around the sacred mountain for 4 days. So here's some photographs. And Sri Krishnamacharya even bathed in the sacred waters of Lake Manasarovar. That's what the documentarian claims. And then there's this evidence from Krishnamacharya's study. Apparently, all that we have are these padukas, these sandals that he received from his teacher, his teacher's sandals, which he honors and bows to. So again, the documentarian says Krishnamacharya spent 7 years with the master Sri Ramamohan Brahmachari, who taught him all the postures, breathing, and therapeutic techniques of yoga. In addition to his philosophy, the only visible signs of his adventure are his master's wooden clogs, which he worships every day, and an album of drawings by his master's daughter. So we'll circle back to this album of drawings that his master gave to him, drawings that were copied out from the master's daughter. We'll circle back to that when we deal with the subject of the Yoga Kurunta. So in any case, that's the story. He was then instructed to come back to Mysore, form a family, and also teach yoga to householders. It said that he first had a job to make ends meet, which was working a coffee plantation while also giving yoga demonstrations and gaining some private yoga students, until he finally impressed the Maharaja, the Mysore king of Mysore, and where Krishnamacharya then gained the employ of the Mysore palace, Jagan Mohan Palace in Mysore. He was the yoga teacher at the Mysore Palace, where he conducted classes at this yoga shala. It is there where he published his book, in 1934, the Yoga Makaranda is a very famous book now. It was originally published in Krishnamacharya's mother tongue in Kannada, and later in Tamil, a few years after the initial publication, and only published posthumously in English translation. So at this point, I'd like to bring our attention to another book publication. So this is the English translation of Krishnamacharya's 1934 work, the Yoga Makaranda. And it's translated here in part by TKV Deshikachar and his son, Kaustub Deshikachar, who is, of course, the grandson of T. Krishnamacharya. So Yoga Makaranda is one of the more well-known works by Sri Tirumalai Krishnamacharya. So I encourage you all to get a copy. This is the publication from Kaustub Deshikachar's publishing house, Media Garuda. Yes. Now, speaking about the Yoga Makaranda, here's a PDF document, not a scan of the book I just showed, but an alternate translation, a translation from the Tamil version, whereas the English translation that Kaustub worked on is a translation of the original Kannada. So some differences are there in the translation here in this document that's floating around the internet. It's considered perhaps an unofficial translation, English translation of the Yoga Makaranda of Krishnamacharya. So this is referring the essence of yoga, Makaranda being like the honey or nectar of yoga. So this book covers a variety of topics. It gets into asana sequencing that is reminiscent of what we see in the Ashtanga Vinyasa presentation of Patabi Joyce, what Krishnamacharya was famously teaching the group classes of teenagers at the Mysore Palace Shala. But that's not the only thing. So this is predominantly what Patabi Joyce transmitted, and the asana system, the kinds of asanas are also what BKS Iyengar was taught and later adapted and was innovating upon that initial system in the inclusion of a variety of props and different prop uses and different setups for props for different asanas. So BKS Iyengar went along those lines. Patabi Joyce was trying to teach the asana system as he learned from Krishnamacharya as a teenager in the Mysore Shala. But if you look even at the evidence found in this 1934 text, this very same Mysore period, he's not just teaching the impressive asanas. Let's give a show of some of the impressive asanas. First of all, let's look at the shala itself. So these are some photographs. There's this one. That's a room that he had. Otherwise, there's this group photo with the young practitioners, the boys of the Mysore Palace days. And then some more photographs here. Group photos. Very rigorous asanas. So it's as evidenced in the rigorous asana sequences that Patabi Joyce propagated. Otherwise, let's go further in the text. You see, we see these rigorous sequences as we see in Ashtanga Vinyasa. This is Krishnamacharya in the first asana, Samastiti. So this is Uttanasana, the variation being Padahastasana, like the hasta, the hands going under the feet. Hasta, pada, Uttanasana. This is Uttanasana in the opposite direction. Tirang Mukha, the opposite direction of Uttanasana. Some other standing postures. And then a sequence to get to the ground. Very rigorous procedures. So of course we have this Chaturanga Dandasana. Danda is a stick or a staff. And Chaturanga, Chatur. Chaturhu is four. Anga, parts, four limbs. So four-limbed stick. There's four parts of the body touching the ground while the body is suspended as a stick. Otherwise we have Urdhva Mukha Svanasana, which here Krishnamacharya indicates to maintain what's known as the Jalandhara Bandha. A lot of people do this posture without the Jalandhara Bandha, but this is the manner in which my teacher Srivatsa Ramaswami teaches this posture. Otherwise, we have Adho Mukha Svanasana, the downward-facing dog. In any case, this is all a means to get to the floor. So it's a very rigorous sequence to get to the floor, to then perform the seated posture like Paschimottanasana, after which it's instructed that one can potentially do this sequence to get back to standing. So it's almost like the reverse to get back to the forward bend and then back up to Samastiti. Very rigorous, and all of the seated postures are described as having such a rigorous entrance and exit. So these kinds of sequences, half lotus, lotus posture of course is a rigorous procedure. Not everyone is capable of doing it. So what Krishnamacharya is showing is a very rigorous procedures. Different than what his son TKV Deshikachar notably was teaching, propagating. So this is a lot of what we see in Patabi Joyce's presentation of Ashtanga Vinyasa, and it's the same kinds of asanas seen in BKS Iyengar's presentation in Light on Yoga. Very rigorous procedures, not for an elder that is beginning their practice for the first time. So Krishnamacharya is showing a classical approach with rigorous procedures, not to say that that's the only and authentic way of practicing, although some people might believe as much. If you look to the teachings of TKV Deshikachar, Krishnamacharya was also allowing for variation. Look at how he taught Indra Devi. He was not teaching extreme rigorous procedures like this Kurmasana. He was not teaching her rigorous procedures like leg behind the head. He was not emphasizing this so much to her. He was not emphasizing all of this to Indra Devi in the same Mysore period. He's and certainly not to Deshikachara, and Deshikachara was highlighting this aspect that actually Krishnamacharya was teaching individually to the needs of the student. So these are, you see, this is Krishnamacharya's young student. So of course, such an asana is appropriate to him, like it was appropriate to Patabi Joyce and to a young BKS Iyengar once he regained health. So when it comes to someone a little older, someone with health complications, it's not these asanas but something more recuperative, breath-centered in any case. What's present in Yoga Makaranda is meant to encourage and inspire people to take on the practice of yoga. In fact, Krishnamacharya often referred to such poses like this as propaganda, yoga propaganda. It's not for everyone, and it's just for the sake of propagation, inspiring persons to continue and commence the study of yoga, to practice yoga. So the point I'm making, showing all these postures, is that yes, of course, Yoga Makaranda shows a lot of the rigorous procedures seen in the Ashtanga Vinyasa system that Patabi Joyce presented, but there's also a lot more that Patabi Joyce actually did not transmit. So if we go back, so other stuff that Krishnamacharya points to, he's talking about the angas, the limbs of yoga, and not shying away from the meditation practice. He's speaking to that. He's not saying yoga practice is merely the practice of rigorous asanas. He's saying yoga practice leads you to sit for meditation. So he speaks about all the limbs. He speaks about the yama and niyamas, which are social disciplines and personal observances. He speaks about certain dietary restrictions or things to consider. And then he talks about nadis and vayus, which are subtle aspects of the human system. Subtle channels where energy is said to move, and the vayus, which are the vital winds that govern the functioning of different systems within the body. He even covers the shat kriyas of the Hatha texts. These are cleansing techniques, some of which are very rigorous, and it's interesting in the fact that Krishnamacharya didn't actually teach a lot of these kriyas. Nevertheless, he presents them in quite specific detail in this book, but he sort of disguises his thoughts on them by only suggesting ones that he considers to be in line with what is called the Raja Yoga. Now, for those that may not know, Hatha Yoga is this yoga practice that is dealing with energy and is dealing with more gross aspects like the body in performing asanas that are more rigorous than just sitting for meditation proper. It's meant to be a preparation towards sitting for meditation proper. In fact, the Hatha texts specifically state that Hatha Yoga is merely a stepladder to reach the higher goal of Raja Yoga. So Raja Yoga is, broadly speaking, the practice of this more subtle techniques, sitting for meditation in order to attain the ultimate realization according to the Shastras. So Hatha Yoga, in terms of the asanas, the breathing techniques called pranayama, is all a means to get to Raja Yoga. And in any case, you need to be following the yama niyama to get any headway in the sadhana, the means, the practice itself, the practice at large. So in any case, some of these shat kriyas he labels as in line with Raja Yoga, what he considers in line with Raja Yoga, whereas some, he says, these are specifically, strictly speaking, Hatha Yoga, for Hatha Yogis. So this is a disguised way of Krishnamacharya basically saying, some of these I don't recommend, and some of these I think are sensible and sound procedures that I consider to be in line with Raja Yoga at large. The same goes for the discussion on mudras. It's a very detailed section on mudras, 20 mudras. These are drawing from the Karanda Samhita, which is another Hatha Yoga text. There's the Hatha Pradipika, very well known, but there's also the Karanda Samhita, which Krishnamacharya is drawing from in terms of the multiple kriyas listed there, elaborating on the initial 6, and the 20 mudras elaborating on the initial 10 found in Hatha Pradipika. So again, in the mudra section, he's also highlighting how some he considers to be in line with Raja Yoga, while others he considers, strictly speaking, for Hatha Yogis proper. So without saying he disagrees with Hatha Yogis at this point in the text, you get as much when you look to the teachings of TKV Deshikchar, A.G. Mohan, Srivatsa Ramaswami. What Krishnamacharya is saying, that those procedures that are specifically and strictly speaking Hatha Yoga and not in line with Raja Yoga, he was very adamantly discouraging. So nevertheless, he's talking about a lot of topics, and these topics aren't really transmitted in the teachings of BKS Iyengar or Pattabhi Joyce in the Ashtanga Vinyasa that he presented. So there's a lot. The point is, there's a lot in this Yoga Makaranda of 1934 that Krishnamacharya published that didn't make it out through the output of his perhaps best known pupils, BKS Iyengar and Pattabhi Joyce. It doesn't mean that Krishnamacharya was not teaching more subjects, as evidenced what he himself published in that very same Mysore period in 1934. So not only that, it's only after he gets into these asanas anyways, the chapter on asanas, but not only that, if you go through it, he's dealing with a lot of subject matter. He's dealing with the nuance of what is considered Brahmana Kriya and Langana Kriya. These terms come up in Ayurveda, but he adapts them to speak in a specific sense according to yoga practice. And he's speaking to the practice of kumbhaka, or holding of the breath, in the practice of non-seated asanas. So not in the seated asanas one takes for seated pranayama proper. He's speaking to the practice of performing kumbhaka in the asanas, the moving, like the non-seated asanas, is what I'm saying, which is something not at all taught in BKS Iyengar's system, nor in Pattabhi Joyce's presentation of the Ashtanga Vinyasa. So again, another element that was not transmitted, that one might not glean so much from the output of Pattabhi Joyce or BKS Iyengar in terms of what Krishnamacharya actually did teach and was aware of. It's not something he only got to later, like some people might suggest. it's not fair to judge Krishnamacharya's teachings primarily and solely through the output of BKS Iyengar and Pattabhi Joyce, because what they're teaching, again, is the specific rigorous asana procedures that they learned as teenagers. And during that exact same period, Krishnamacharya was aware of and also teaching to other individuals about these other topics, such as holding of the breath while doing non-seated asanas, and the nuance between the such kumbhakas being either Brahmana Kriya or Langana Kriya, moving, jumping while holding the breath, whether it be on the inhale hold, which is Brahmana Kriya, or Langana Kriya, which is exhale hold. So this nuance, not found in the output of BKS Iyengar or Pattabhi Joyce, but is taught by TKV Deshikachar and Srivatsa Ramaswami and A.G. Mohan. These aspects are taught by these teachers. The pupils of Krishnamacharyas that stayed with him for a significant amount of time, 20, 30 years. So that's a big difference. They weren't just taught a practice for healthy, athletic teenagers. They were taught something over the course of 20, 30 years that got more and more broadly into Krishnamacharya's knowledge. He was sharing a lot with such individuals. So in this text, he's getting into this. He's also getting into samantraka practice. So this is the practice of asanas and pranayama utilizing mantra. This, again, is another aspect that is not found in the output of BKSA Iyengar or Patabi Joyce's presentation of Ashtanga Vinyasa. Yet, this is found in Krishnamacharya's 1934 work. It wasn't something he added later. It was there. It's only evidenced as something later because we don't see it in BKSA Iyengar or Patabi Joyce. You see it in TKV Deshikachar and Srivatsa Ramaswami and A.G. Mohan. So these aspects you see in their teaching. Kumbhakas and asanas, you see this in Krishnamacharya's other son also, TK Sri Bhashyam. So for the long-standing pupils of Krishnamacharya's, you see more of these nuances, you know? So samantraka practice, that's quite significant. The use of mantra, which relates to Krishnamacharya's orthodoxy. He was a very orthodox man. He was Brahmana caste, and he was strictly observant of the daily sun ritual, Sandhya Vandana, and all the Vedic rituals. And the Vedic rituals make use of what's known as nyasa procedures, hand placements, and they are supported with mantras. And these procedures are leading to and preparing one toward japa, recitation of mantra, the Vedic mantra. And afterward, there's also a procedure of coming out of the japa recitation through another series of nyasas with supporting mantras. So there's a progression there, the preparation towards the main event, which is the japa recitation. There's a certain krama, progression and steps. And nyasa, if you look at the term vinyasa, this is where it's coming from. Vinyasa, the prefix vi is denoting vishesha, which is unique, particular nyasa, particular placement in this case of the body. So the vinyasa krama is particular placement of the body in steps. So it implies a progression and counterbalancing. So this is the same procedure that we see in Krishnamacharya's adherence to this strict adherence to the Vedic ritual practice and meditation as considered through that perspective, the Vedic perspective. So there's a lot in this Yoga Makaranda, let alone what he's transmitting in Yoga Rahasya, which is dealing with adapting practice according to stages of life. The appropriateness of yoga to women, Krishnamacharya is speaking of. In the Yoga Rahasya, he's talking about yoga for internal organs and the chikitsa aspects of yoga, the therapeutic aspects through pranayama and mudras like Maha Mudra. And he's talking about bhakti, devotion, and he's talking about meditation on the Lord. So there's a lot there in the Yoga Rahasya that's not propagated in the output of BKSA Iyengar and Patabi Joyce, let alone in Yoga Makaranda, which, grossly speaking, of course, we see the asanas. Patabi Joyce, in no small part, was propagating that. But there's all this nuance that's not presented in the output of BKS Iyengar or Pattabhi Joyce. That's the point I'm making here. Now, I'll go back to the bibliography that Krishnamacharya includes. So this is of note. Put full screen. So Krishnamacharya lists various sources that he uses for the purpose of putting together this book. Like as I mentioned earlier, the kriyas and the mudras owe in no small part the Hatha text, the Gheranda Samhita. But of course, he's also referring the Hatha Pradipika, which is very well known, the Hatha Yoga Pradipika. But of course, he's also praising the Yoga Sutra of Patanjali. So the Patanjali Yoga Darshanam. And then there's other texts. So there's the Yoga Yajnavalkya, which is apparently a Hatha-based text, but from a Vedantin lens. So it's very much in line with Krishnamacharya's perspective. It's actually a very important text for Krishnamacharya that he actually considered in many ways more important to him than the Hatha Pradipika itself. The Hatha Pradipika is broadly considered by most Western academics as well as a compilation. So it's drawing from various sources, sometimes contradictory, and various techniques that are not accepted across the board with all practitioners in India. And Krishnamacharya was among such practitioners that dismissed certain practices, such as the kriyas and mudras that were what he considered, more strictly speaking, Hatha Yoga procedures and formulations, as opposed to some of those mudras and kriyas that he considered more so in line with Raja Yoga, which he accepted. But in any case, there's also some Yoga Upanishads that he turns to, Dhyana Bindu Upanishad, Chandu Upanishad, Yogashika Upanishad, Yoga Kundalya Upanishad. So Nara Bindu Upanishad, Amrita Bindu Upanishad, Garbha Upanishad. So these are Yoga Upanishads that are much like the Yoga Yajnavalkya, that they're coming from a Vedantin perspective, yet including certain Hatha procedures. So it's different than the Hatha Pradipika, which is a bit more coming from a tantric lens. The Yoga Yajnavalkya is more so coming from a Vedic perspective, which is in line with Krishnamacharya's personal view. Nevertheless, Krishnamacharya does include some Pancharatra Vaishnavite Tantrika sources, like the Narada Pancharatra Samhita. So Vaishnavite tantric text, or the Ahirbhudnya Samhita, or the Rudra Yamilam, Brahma Yamilam. These are Vaishnavite tantric texts that Krishnamacharya was also referring to. And now I'll bring particular attention to the Sritattvanidhi. This is a particular text that Norman Shulman published some research on in the 1990s. At this time, he wasn't aware of some older sources, and Krishnamacharya wasn't bringing up the famous source that we see in the Ashtanga mythology, the Yoga Kurunta. This is not among the list of 27 sources that Krishnamacharya includes in this bibliography in his Yoga Makaranda. Nevertheless, he includes this Sritattvanidhi. Now, what is the Sritattvanidhi? So, The Sritattvanidhi is a voluminous work that includes explanations of various cultural elements and disciplines, various traditional disciplines and procedures and techniques. So it's not solely dealing with yoga at all. So it's compiled, it's a compilation that is compiled by the mid 19th century Maharaja of Mysore. So Krishnamacharya, of course, was employed by the late 1920s Maharaja of Mysore, the descendant of this Maharaja from the mid 19th century. So Krishnamacharya was referring to the Yogasana section of the Sritattvanidhi, while the Sritattvanidhi speaks broadly about various disciplines, not just yoga. The yoga section is quite small. So you can see dealing with various subjects. So it's an illustrated document from the mid 19th century. And it's dealing with the Indian dance tradition, like I said, different disciplines, cultural disciplines. It was in no small part part of an agenda of the Maharaja to bring back some cultural traditions and disciplines that were systematically being eradicated. They were disappearing, of course, because in the 19th century there was British occupation. So a lot of disciplines were disappearing. So the Maharaja of the mid 19th century was compiling this text to sort of try to inspire the Indian countrymen to retake some of their old cultural traditions. So here you can see some of these illustrated passages from the Sritattvanidhi dealing with various disciplines. Now, according to the relevant section on yoga asanas, we have to look at the publication by Norman Shulman, where he publishes a book in the 1990s, specifically in considering the yoga tradition of the Mysore Palace. So that's referring largely what Krishnamacharya transmitted. Now at this time, what Norman Shulman is showing with the Sritattvanidhi, he's highlighting the fact that it is mid-19th century in the midst of British occupation. So while this Sritattvanidhi section on yogasanas is quite compelling, it's compiled by older yoga shastras, as the compiler notes. A lot of these asana procedures are quite athletic, rigorous, repetitive, dynamic, very interesting, and is reminiscent of some of the jumping movements that you do see in Krishnamacharya's presentation of Yoga Makaranda. So Krishnamacharya literally is citing the Sritattvanidhi as one such source to his Yoga Makaranda. So if we glance at some of these pictorials, here's the Sritattvanidhi Yogasana section. It's written in the, I believe, in the Kannada script. It's Sanskrit, but in the Kannada script, I believe. So very impressive procedures. There's the plow pose as we know it. So anyways, some of the stuff is unusual, or we can't quite make sense of what's happening in the image and the description, but there's a lot of stuff that we can recognize today. Shoulder stand, lying, these are lying on the back, this is lying on the abdomen, facing down. And this is a rolling movement to get you from lying on the back to flip over to then lie on the stomach. There's arm balances, impressive procedures are found in this. So it's not an old text. The older texts that were known at the time of Norman Schoen's research were Hathapradipika, Garanda Samhita. And the Hathapradipika only has, let's say, 15 asanas. Garanda Samhita only has 32 asanas, let alone the section on pranayama and mudras. And the fourth chapter of Hathapradipika deals with samadhi, raja yoga. So here in the Sritattvanidhi, we have 122 asanas described and illustrated, which is quite impressive. Beyond the 15 asanas described in the Hathapradipika and the 32 described in the Garanda Samhita. And there's arm balances, like I said, and all sorts of varieties. Even rope postures. And this is reminiscent of something we see today that's also pictured in Krishnamacharya's Yoga Makaranda. So a lot of impressive, rigorous procedures. Now, going back to Krishnamacharya's Yoga Makaranda, where did Krishnamacharya get the asanas that are in Yoga Makaranda from? Did he get them from Sritattvanidhi? Because he's presenting a lot more asanas than are found in Hathapradipika or in the Yoga Yajnavalkya or in Garanda Samhita. He's presenting a lot more asanas. Where are they coming from? Well, Sritattvanidhi is showing a lot, but did Krishnamacharya not know about these asanas before coming under the employ of the Maharaja of Mysore? No, of course not. He learned a very detailed asana breathing system through his teacher, Sri Ramamohan Brahmachari. So the understanding is that he learned these asanas and the sequences and the system of movement and breathing in a dynamic fashion from his teacher, Sri Ramamohan Brahmachari. Of course, the Western academics doubt that this teacher of Krishnamacharya even exists. They think Krishnamacharya invented these sequences, as evidenced in Norman Shulman's research, where he's saying, well, Sritattvanidhi exists in the midst of the British occupation, so it still might be influenced by the British occupiers, as does the presentation of Mark Singleton in his Yoga Body seems to suggest as well. So if we go to the relevant section where Singleton deals with Mysore tradition. Here. He seems to suggest that Krishnamacharya is drawing from physical culture of the British occupiers. So, and he draws into question the Yoga Kurunta, which also David Gordon White brings into question. I already explained a way of understanding the Yoga Rahasya. Now, how do we understand the Yoga Kurunta? First, I'll explain the story for those that may not know. So Ashtanga Vinyasa has this mythology about this long-lost text called the Yoga Kurunta. It's said to have been lost to time, last copies being unfortunately eaten by ants, because they were written on banana leaves and notated in Sanskrit in these old manuscripts. So it's said to have been lost, and that Krishnamacharya transmitted this text as he learned it from his teacher, Sri Ramamohan Brahmacharya, and he transmitted it to Pathabi Joyce. And Pathabi Joyce says that this Yoga Kurunta contained the Ashtanga Vinyasa system, these series of asanas. But there's no way to verify this, there's no evidence. So, for lack of evidence, for a long time, the Western academics thought that surely Krishnamacharya was drawing from gymnastics, so gymnastics Indian and foreign, supposedly drawing from foreign sources, like in this book, Gymnasium, Denmark, Danish gymnastics. So no doubt there's similarities, but at the same time, there's certain unique procedures that are seen in yoga, the pranayama, the mudras. Of course, there's people going up into headstand here, but this was something well documented in pre-colonial times. This, in the Hatha Pradipika, speaking about the inversion mudra, Viparita Karuni mudra. So that's the inversion process. That's well documented, very much pre-colonial times. But then as far as some of the other procedures, like these standing postures, these are not documented in early Hatha texts, certainly not in the Hatha Pradipika, not in the Gheranda Samhita. And I'll say, even in this Sritattvanidhi, the postures, we don't see these kinds of postures, but we do see many other things that do relate to what we do see. So if the Western academics have one point, it can only be made about such standing postures. Nevertheless, I always bring this up, is that such standing postures are some of the most basic movements one can do whilst standing. So it's a bit of an absurdity to suggest that these positions were not known to the Indian people in pre-colonial times. So, in fact, if we look at some evidence, the Indian mythology often has deities in positions, standing positions anyway, that are reminiscent of some such standing positions, like here, like this, might you say this is a Virudrasana stance, the warrior pose that Shiva is standing in. Or maybe in the dance tradition, the Indian dance tradition, some such standing position is very reminiscent to what we do see in these sequences, the standing sequences that Krishnamacharya taught, let alone the other such sequences. The other such sequences, I will say, like I said, these standing positions are the only area the Western academics have something to say. There's no depictions in Hatha Yoga sources, specifically, having to do with such standing asanas. But I am drawing our attention to Indian dance tradition, in Indian mythology, and the depictions, the iconography. These positions were not unknown to the Indian people in pre-colonial times. So that's how I would bring this up. But the other such asanas certainly have basis, I would say, in pre-colonial times. The seated forward bending movement, Paschimottanasana, is well known in Hatha Pradipika, very much established in pre-colonial times. And then you can come to variations of this, doing it with one leg. In fact, the Mahamudra resembles this. Then there's the Viparita Karani Mudra, like I said, it's an inversion process. There's the twist in the Hatha-pradipika, the Matsyendrasana, an advanced seated twist. There's arm balances like Kukutasana or Mayurasana. These are found in Hatha-pradipika. So many such asanas. And the Gheranda Samhita has prone postures like Bhujangasana and Shalabhasana. So we have prone postures like this. Now the Sritattvanidhi, we saw some postures even done on the lying on one's back, lying on one's belly. We already saw postures lying on one's belly in the Gheranda Samhita. But in any case, again, the Sritattvanidhi is considered in the midst of British occupation, so Norman Shoman did not disqualify the possibility that it was still, by chance, influenced by, British occupiers, military drills, European gymnastics as such. Nevertheless, the compiler of the Sritattvanidhi explains that he's compiling the section on yogasanas from various yoga shastras. Now, there's a subsequent researcher that is in more recent times, Jason Birch, that brought to light a text by the name of Hathabhyasa-paddhati. And in fact, the Kaivalya Dhamma Institute also published a full translation of the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. So here it is, the Kaivalya Dhamma Institute publication of the Hathabhyasa-paddhati of Kapalakurantaka. So now I'll bring the attention to the author's name, Kapalakurantaka. This has the exact same asana descriptions as found in the Sritattvanidhi. The only difference is that they are in a different order. They're more coherent in terms of grouping asanas together in particular categories. Also, this is a more complete book on Hatha Yoga than what's found in the Sritattvanidhi, which isn't even strictly having to do with yoga. It's talking variously about different disciplines, with a small section on yogasanas, whereas this text, which seems to be at least one of the yoga shastras that are sources for the compiler of the Sritattvanidhi section on yogasanas, this has more discussion on the practice of Hathabhyasa at large. It deals with the where the yogin is practicing, the type of hut that they are practicing in. It deals with the yamas and niyamas in more elaboration than found in the Yoga Sutra. More elaboration also than found in the Yoga Yajnavalkya. And then there's the section of 112 asanas, a remarkable number. And it's all those same asanas that we saw illustrated in the Sritattvanidhi, the exact same descriptions. And then there's a section on the Hatha Kriyas, and a section on Pranayama, and then the section on the Hatha Mudras. The only thing is that the text, at least the Pune manuscript, that is the only manuscript that is available for critical analysis, which is the same manuscript that was utilized for the publication by Kaivalya Dhamma Institute, and also what Jason Birch has been working on. He put out a couple essays on this text, but hasn't published as of yet the complete translation of the text, although you can refer to the Kaivalya Dhamma publication. So going back to here, if we look at Birch, one such essay he has is the proliferation of asanas in the late medieval yoga texts. So this is a specific term he's coining, late medieval. So if Hatha Pradipika is really medieval period text. This Hathabhyasa-paddhati that preceded the Sritattvanidhi is considered late medieval, and it's 18th century. It's in the middle of the 18th century. Sritattvanidhi is mid-19th century, and the Hathabhyasa-paddhati is in the 18th century, and that places it pre-British occupation. So as such, the evidence of those asanas were in existence pre-British occupation. So there's a long-standing tradition then of such dynamic procedures that are dynamic as such, the jumping procedures, repetitive arm balance movements beyond what was seen in Hathapradipika, for example, or Garanda Samhita. And there's a whole category of supine positions in this pre-colonial work. There's prone positions, there's a variety of seated variations, a section on standing variations. Of course, we don't see those familiar positions like Trikonasana, triangle, or Virabhadrasana, warrior. But then, like I said, if we look at such examples, it's not as if such positions were unknown to the Indian people. It's just not documented in Hatha works. Nevertheless, if we look at such a late medieval work as the Hathabhyasa-paddhati, we do see a lot of interesting things that we'd be short-sighted if we were to ignore. So we also see this essay dealing specifically with the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. It's primarily Jason Birch's research, but Mark Singleton contributes to it. Some of the materials that he was working on in his research in Yoga Body, for example. So this Hathabhyasa-paddhati, very interesting. One second. And so where does Krishnamacharya get this Hathabhyasa-paddhati then? We know he refers the Sritattvanidhi in his 1934 Yoga Makaranda, but where does the story about Yoga Kurunta come from? Well, if we refer to another text, another book that Krishnamacharya published, unfortunately hasn't been translated in an official capacity, but there's an unofficial translation that exists of this text, the Yogasanagalu of T. Krishnamacharya. We do have reference in the bibliography. It's just shorter bibliography here. He refers Patanjali Yoga Sutra, Hatha Yoga Pradipika of Swatmarama, Raja Yoga Ratnakara. And here we have the reference of Yoga Kurunti. So is that the same as Yoga Kurunta? Possibly, maybe alternate spelling. Is it having to do with this author mentioned that supposedly composed the Hathabhyasa-paddhati? The author is Kapalakurantaka. Is this the same? This is what Jason Birch speculates in his essay on the Hathabhyasa-paddhati of Kapalakurantaka. In any case, there's also reference to Yoga Upanishads and, of course, Krishnamacharya mentioning his learning from his guru, Sri Rama Mohan Ramachari, and his self-experience. There's supposedly an official translation of the Yogasanagalu coming down the pipeline that Kaustubh Deshikachar had announced. I don't know when plans are to be in the publication, the official publication of this English translation of Yogasanagalu. In any case, this is where we see mention of Yoga Kurunti in a Krishnamacharya work. There's a text that's attributed to Krishnamacharya, but it's not so clear whether it is or is not a composition by Krishnamacharya. A.G. Mohan speaks about it, and this is this document that's floating around called Salutation to the Teacher and the Eternal One. It may very well be a compilation of notes from A.G. Mohan, for all we know, that was circulating amongst students at the Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram. In any case, it's very much within the approach of Sri T Krishnamacharya. So whether it's literally composed by Sri T Krishnamacharya or his pupil A.G. Mohan, we don't know. But it's very much written within this scope and context and concept of the Krishnamacharya teachings as we know it from Srivatsa Ramaswami, A.G. Mohan, T.K.V. Deshikachar. This is very much coming from this point of view. Anyways, we have mention of Yoga Kuruntam in this particular text. So anyways, these are mentions where Krishnamacharya directly mentions such a text. And now going back to this document I had here earlier. So the only evidence of Krishnamacharya having learned from this Sri Rama Mohan Brahmachari is allegedly this these padukas, these sandals that he received from his teacher, his teacher's sandals, and an album of drawings by his master's daughter. His master gave this album to him, drawings copied out by the master's daughter. So if we see some examples, this of course is in possession of Kaustub, these archival documents, and these drawings look remarkably similar to the style of drawings and the types of asanas depicted as seen in the illustrated Sritattvanidhi, let alone the few folios that we have seen of the illustrated Mysore manuscript of the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. So let's take a look at that. This is what was given to Krishnamacharya. This is supposed to be a posture that is remarkably similar to what's seen in the Sritattvanidhi. This is called Dhenukasana, which is another term for cow pose. The legs are reminiscent of what we know today in terms of the cow pose, the Gomukhasana, another name to say go, as another name to say cow. Mukha, face. So in that context, it's referring to cow's face. In any case, it's the posture we recognize today. Here, this is not a posture we recognize today. The name given in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati and Sritattvanidhi is Dvishirshasana, two-head pose, very unusual pose. But you can see the drawing that was given to Krishnamacharya is identical to the, more or less, to the drawing in the illustrated Sritattvanidhi. And the description is obviously identical between Hathabhyasa-paddhati and Sritattvanidhi. And this drawing that was given to Krishnamacharya, identical to that which is found in the Sritattvanidhi, which is, of course, the same description in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. This pose as well. As what's interesting also down to the detail of what kind of rug the yogin is sitting on, some of which there's no rug, but then here there's a tiger skin, here there's a tiger skin, here there's a tiger skin in the same direction that the head of the tiger is looking, here too, and here that there's no tiger skin, it's similar. And they're in the same order as they appear in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. So here's the Baddha Padmasana, the bound lotus, and the Kukutasana. So it's in progression of Padmasana postures, like a sequence. So Krishnamacharya's album of drawings bearing remarkable resemblance to those illustrated in the Sritattvanidhi and in the order that they appear in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati of Kapalakurantaka. We have this drawing, which is of the same style that we've seen in the Sritattvanidhi illustrated manuscript. This, which is with a belt, yoga belt pose. This, which is a pose that we see in the, even as far back as the Hatha Pradipika, if not earlier. The Uttana Kurmasana, the upturned turtle pose, in which we take the legs into lotus and then thread the arms through and then lie on our back. Here, it's like a one-legged Kukutasana, one-legged rooster. So it's referred as the Pangu Kukutasana, the injured rooster pose. So it's very interesting. The drawing is mostly identical. Even this strange pose that's referred to as the Hridjanu Samyogasana. Same drawing, just a mirror image. Here, same image, more or less, except there's no animal skin, animal hide that the yogin is sitting on. There's a difference there, but the foot placement is identical. This is, of course, the same as what we see in the Sritattvanidhi and is as described in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. And this is a picture of the professor's eldest son, Srinivasan, demonstrating in the photograph that appears in the documentary from the 1988 centenary celebrations of Krishnamacharya. So they compare this photo of Sri Krishnamacharya's eldest son to the picture as given to him from his acharya. And that's, again, remarkably similar to the drawing as it appears in the Sritattvanidhi illustrated manuscript. This dhanurasana, specifically qualified as akarna dhanurasana, to the ear bow pose, otherwise known as the archer's pose. So this is also with a comparison to a photo seen with the professor's eldest son demonstrating such an asana. So mirror image in the Sritattvanidhi, but it's the same asana. This pose appears also as early as the Hatha Pradipika, if not earlier. This pose as well, the drawing in Sritattvanidhi is merely a mirror image to it. This pose as well. And this is the interpretation of Krishnamacharya's eldest son performing a prone posture by the name of Raja Kapotasana, the king pigeon, the king pigeon pose. The name, of course, that's appearing in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati and the Sritattvanidhi is different in any case. But this is just a difference in nomenclature according to different lineage schools. And then we see this. This can be interpreted in a couple of ways, but what's interpreted in terms of what's depicted in the 1988 documentary, they show this photo compared to the photo of Krishnamacharya's eldest son in Mayurasana, but with the legs in Padmasana, lotus. In any case, it's the same or identical drawing as seen in the Sritattvanidhi. So Krishnamacharya was aware of basically the asanas seen in Sritattvanidhi before he was under the employ of the Maharaja in Mysore, supposedly as early as his instruction under his guru, Sri Ramamohan Brahmachari, in which he was given this album of drawings, of which the master's daughter copied out for Krishnamacharya. And we know that Krishnamacharya was transmitted this text called Yoga Kurunti. So perhaps this is the Yoga Kurunta that we're often told about. It's just that we're not shown Ashtanga Vinyasa series like is told in the Ashtanga Vinyasa mythology surrounding the Yoga Kurunta. In any case, like I said, the same asanas that appear in Sritattvanidhi are in this Hathabhyasa-paddhati of Kapalakurantaka, which it seems Krishnamacharya was certainly aware of, going as far back as his formative years in instruction under Sri Ramamohan Brahmachari. So there is an Ashtanga Vinyasa series depicted, but in this Hathabhyasa-paddhati that retains a sequential coherence not seen in the later compilation of Sritattvanidhi, the Hathabhyasa-paddhati has a coherent sequence structure that is very compelling, and not to mention that the asanas themselves are dynamic, and there's an incorporation of jumping procedures, repetitive movements, dynamic movements, poses proposed in a sequential order. There's even few instances where there's a breath indication in regard to the asana, such as kumbhaka or breath with sound. So this is remarkable because there's no such indications in earlier Hatha texts like the Hatha Pradipika or Gharanda Samhita. They're not indicating, as far as the asanas are concerned, there's not so much an indication about what to do with the breath. So where does this instruction that's common in Krishnamacharya teachings in regard to conducting ujjayi breathing in the practice of non-seated asanas, where does that come from? Well, like I said, there's these few cryptic indications of manipulating the breath whilst performing non-seated asanas within this Hathabhyasa-paddhati of Kapalakurantaka, which of course, like I've been saying, is copied into the compilation that is the Yogasana section of the Sritattvanidhi. And here's again the Kukutasana with the comparison to Krishnamacharya's eldest son performing the asana. This pose, like I mentioned, appears in the Hatha Pradipika, the Baddha Padmasana as well. And another drawing of the Akarna Dhanurasana, different than what we saw earlier. So Krishnamacharya's album of drawings has this drawing of Akarna Dhanurasana and this drawing here. And here's a drawing of Matsyendrasana, the seated twist. This is an asana that appears in Hatha Pradipika as well. And here are the Sritattvanidhi illustrations. Note that they are in the... So this is the 109th asana in the Sritattvanidhi, the 51st in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. Any case, there's some folios that Kaustub shares of these archival documents that includes some of these rope postures that we do see in the later Sritattvanidhi illustrations. And as described in this Hathabhyasa-paddhati, these rope postures are quite fascinating. So there's this section on rope postures. This is actually a folio of the manuscript in possession by the Mysore Palace. This is unfortunately not among the manuscripts that was studied under Jason Birch and the Kaivalya-Dhamma Institute. They only had access to a manuscript available in a library in Pune, the Pune manuscript. So there exists in the possession of the Mysore Palace a manuscript of this Hathabhyasa-paddhati in addition to the Sritattvanidhi that we know. And this Hathabhyasa-paddhati manuscript is in fact illustrated, just like it is in the Sritattvanidhi. It's the exact same style of illustration, so that's remarkable. And this is the Sritattvanidhi photos in the order as appearing in this folio from the Mysore manuscript of the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. So it's the same order as seen in the Una manuscript. So this Utkatasana, this is an old asana that is referred to even in the Hatha Pradipika Shavasana as well. As well as this seated pose, Vajrasana. So in any case, like I said, we don't see Ashtanga Vinyasa in the Yoga Kapalakurantaka, if you will. But we do see, like I said, very remarkable features, such as sequential order asanas. Let me pull up another document. This one here, not this one, but so there's another document that I put together in which I organized the pictorials from the illustrated Sritattvanidhi into the order of the asanas as they are described in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. So there's a particular sequential order seen in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati that's not retained in the later Sritattvanidhi. So there's a whole section on supine asanas. It's called Uttana asanas. Uttana means looking up. So this order is not completely retained in the later Sritattvanidhi, but in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati, it's organized in this particular order. And there's a very interesting sequence of events, supine postures that essentially are leading us towards a shoulder stand, which then progresses to a plow pose. And the term used here is Lungalasana, is another term for plow pose. The term that we know today as plow pose is another word for plow, which is hala, so halasana. Otherwise, there's this progression of a back bend with the hands and feet apart, and then walking the hands toward the feet in a deeper sort of back bend. And then immediately after, it says, following that pose, place the back on the floor and create like a ball as you take the knees towards the forehead. So it's described in this particular order. So it is a progression and then a counter pose. That's remarkable, a remarkable feature of this text. This pose is described with a kumbhaka breath retention, and it's a non-seated asana. The next sequence, well, first of all, at the end of this sequence, there's the movement, a dynamic movement to move from a supine position into a prone position. This is a common movement that we see in the Ashtanga Vinyasa series. BKS Iyengar teaches it as well. And Ramaswami also teaches something similar. And this leads us to this whole section on prone postures. And again, the Hathabhyasa-paddhati retains a coherent order to this prone sequence, which is not retained so much in the later Sritattvanidhi compilation. So here, Nubjasanas, these prone postures. So these resemble things described in the Garanda Samhita. There's the, like I said, Bhujangasana and Shalabhasana, cobra and locust poses, even appearing as early as the Garanda Samhita, at least. In any case, we see more such prone positions, including this, which is remarkable. It looks like a downward facing dog, as we know it today, Adho Mukha Svanasana. Although in this text, it's referred to as the elephant pose, Gajasana. So this pose is described by breathing with a particular sound. That's also a remarkable indication. There's arm balances as part of this prone sequence because we're meant to jump into certain arm balances from the Gajasana, this elephant pose, including the Mayurasana, this peacock pose, which again is an old pose that dates back to the Hathabhyasa-paddhatika and even the Yoga Yajnavalkya prior to that. It's a very old asana. In any case, prone positions, a headstand features as part of this. The following group is called sthanasanas, stable seated group. So predominantly seated positions. We have the paschimottanasana, which again is an old asana that we see mentioned and description of in the Shiva Samhita and in the Hatha Pradipika, etc., Gheranda Samhita. The one leg paschimottanasana, this more advanced, it's a progression, the more advanced type of paschimottanasana in this text is called Urdhva Paschimottanasana, but of course we know it today as a vinyasa from the Ekaparishirshasana vinyasa sequence. In Krishnamacharya's book Yoga Makaranda, he refers to this forward bend as Skandasana. In any case, we have Akarna Dhanurasana, as we've seen. This is an unusual pose, but it seems to draw from wrestling traditions. In any case, we have lotus poses here. We have these that are on the knees kneeling, which in Krishnamacharya's nomenclature, he calls these as deriving from the Vajrasana sequence. We have other such poses, squatting, in which we wrap the arms around. So Ramaswami calls these Malasana and Kanchyasana. Malasana, garland pose, Kanchyasana is golden belt pose. Anyways, there's a lot of poses that we can recognize here, like Dandasana. And even this pose, where it's meant to be swinging between these two, they call it like Prinkasana, like a swing. In fact, there is a swing type pose, pendant pose, in today's nomenclature, Lolasana. Here, it's like a jump through, in any case, jumping through to the straight legs to sit down later, like Dandasana, like we do see in Ashtanga Vinyasa. So very rigorous dynamic procedures. The standing Uttanasanas, standing upright, extended. So we have squatting positions, we have one leg squatting positions, we have variations of standing on one leg, the movement that is trying to depict the dancing Shiva performing his famous dance, Tandava dance. There's standing on one leg, but with the opposite leg behind the head. So many variations of leg behind the head, as we've seen also in Krishnamacharya's Yoga Makaranda. All sorts of movements, some of which are unusual, like jumping through the arms like so. But this one we've seen looks like Uttita Hasta Parangushtasana, standing on the toes. This is something that we see in Krishnamacharya's Yoga Makaranda, which he calls Tadasana. This is the potter's pose, meant to be twisting or turning like the wheel, the potter's wheel. This, remarkably reminiscent to the Vatayanasana, horse pose. In this text, I think it's called Garudasana, which we recognize as another type of one-leg pose. But in any case, the nomenclature is just different according to different schools. And after the standing group, note that there's no Trikonasanas, like I've mentioned. That's the one place where the Western academics have a point. But like I said, those are some of the most basic movements one can make whilst standing with the feet apart. So take that as you will. And then the next section is on these rope postures, where they're grouped together in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. It's interesting to note that BKS Iyengar eventually developed different kinds of rope postures. He was inspired by the concept of yogis practicing such rope postures, but he developed his own rope postures are not exactly related to what we see here, but it's obviously inspired by it. And then this last section, the sixth section in the asanas from the Hathabhyasa-paddhati, sort of miscellaneous. Nevertheless, the heading given is Piercing the Sun and the Moon, which is kind of an unusual title. It doesn't explain what that means or how it's supposed to be done, but it's given that these asanas are meant to fulfill that function. We have recognizable asanas like Utkatasana, Shavasana. We have Padmasana. We have Matsyendrasana, the twist that we see even in the Hatha Pradipika, the seated twist. And in fact, the one of the manuscripts of the Hatha Pradipika, in its description of the Matsyendrasana, the benefits given is that it stimulates the kundalini to rise in terms of the Surya and Chandra nadis. So maybe that's an indication that's given here, that's a nod to this particular manuscript of the Hatha Pradipika that alludes to an effect on the nadis. In any case, otherwise, this is the orders of the asanas as seen in the Sritattvanidhi, not completely as coherent as seen in the earlier Hathabhyasa-paddhati. So, like I said, there's no Ashtanga Vinyasa series as we know them. Here's an example of the Ashtanga Vinyasa series. Philippa Asher demonstrating, standing, well, like the Surya Namaskar, the standing asanas primary series, the ending sequence. And also the intermediate series. So after performing the standing, the Surya Namaskar and standing asanas, to then follow with the intermediate series and then finishing with the finishing sequence. Otherwise, there's the advanced sequences. So these, although we can recognize elements, these are not exactly what we are seeing in this Hathabhyasa-paddhati. Nevertheless, it's very compelling that asanas are organized in sequence of plane of movement, and some of which movements and asanas we definitely recognize. Otherwise, where do these Ashtanga Vinyasa series come from, if not in this Hathabhyasa-paddhati of Kapalakurantaka, which may or may not be related to the so-called Yoga Kurunta that everyone's been speaking about? Well, in that Yogasanagalu of Krishnamacharya, we do have mention of particular series of asanas listed as primary, middle, and proficient. There's even listing of the number of vinyasas for each of these asanas. They're not exactly in the order as seen in the Ashtanga Vinyasa primary series, intermediate series, and the advanced series, but they're very remarkably similar. So this being primary sequence, the intermediate middle group, and then there's the proficient, which starts over here and continued here. So that's quite remarkable. They're quite similar. to what we do see in Ashtanga Vinyasa, not entirely similar, but remarkably similar. So it's not an invention of Patabi Joyce. It does come from Krishnamacharya to a certain extent. Although Krishnamacharya, like I said, was not teaching this to Indra Devi during these same Mysore years. He was teaching her something else. So as far as I can ascertain, I would actually classify these series perhaps as demonstration series, maybe for examination of the young athletic teenagers that were attending the group classes at the Mysore Shala. Otherwise, Krishnamacharya was not advising people to practice an entire series of 60-70 asanas as appear in a single series as such. Like the Ashtanga Vinyasa series, primary series is 70 asanas, intermediate series is something like 70 asanas. So otherwise, Krishnamacharya was not really advising people in their actual day-to-day practice to be practicing so many asanas. He was advising people to practice relevant asanas for them for the day, perhaps 20, 30 asanas in a day, not 70, and not so varied either. Like if you take the intermediate series, there's so many varieties. There's prone backbending, and all of a sudden there's leg behind the head. So it's quite opposite. Whereas the Vinyasa Krama that Ramaswami explains is that if you're going to work on a progression towards leg behind the head, one would do that. But you wouldn't be also doing backbends that progress to Kapotasana, which is quite advanced backbend. It would be one or the other. Whereas in this sequence, it's organized all together in a sort of compilation of asanas that make up a particular syllabus, perhaps. So perhaps these are just collections of syllabus, primary syllabus, the middle group, intermediate syllabus, and then the advanced syllabus. That's the way I take it to be, just a sequence of asanas as according to a particular syllabus, perhaps for demonstration purposes, maybe for examination. Not exactly indicative of what Krishnamacharya was actually advising people to undertake for their actual personal practice. In any case, this is where we can say where perhaps Patabi Joyce is coming from, Krishnamacharya's lists of asanas as appearing from his Yogasanagalu, which he was likely teaching folks like Patabi Joyce and BKS Anger during the Mysore years in the 1930s and 40s. So with that, I'll conclude. So like I said, the Hathabhyasa-paddhati doesn't have Ashtanga Vinyasa sequences, but it has stuff that's remarkably resembling in stuff we do recognize today. And if we go back to this text that is not certain whether it's composed by Krishnamacharya or not, or maybe it was compiled by his pupil A.G. Mohan, Salutation to the Teacher and the Eternal One, we do see these sorts of categorizations, standing categorizations, sitting categorizations, lying down, which is either facing upward, which is supine, or facing downward, which is prone, or sideways, topsy-turvy, turning, jumping, pumping, weighing. And then there's examples given for each of these categories, of which there's the mention of Yoga Kuruntam here. So here it's mentioned Yoga Kuruntam by Matsyendra and Gorakshanath. So these are the original preceptors of the Hatha Yoga. So it's not mentioned as composed by Kuruntaka or Kapalakurantaka. In any case, the name Yoga Kuruntam is given. In fact, the mythology given in Ashtanga Vinyasa is that Yoga Kurunta is composed by a rishi by the name of Vamana. So we don't know if it's really the same. In any case, Ramaswami mentions Yoga Kurunta, Dashikachar mentions it, but they're not speaking of it in terms of depicting Ashtanga Vinyasa like is so in the mythology given in Ashtanga Vinyasa, what Ramaswami and Dasgupta are speaking to is that Yogacaranta supposedly had indications for yoga therapy, which of course we don't see in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. Also, supposedly Yogacaranta was giving indications for this particular type of breath-centered practice, which again, it's not directly depicted in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati, although there's this remarkable descriptions of few asanas with breath indication, which is not all that common in terms of the descriptions of performing pranayama-like procedures while performing non-seated asanas. Now, in terms of these kinds of categories, I'll just conclude by showing Ramaswamy's book, which I'll show also here, is that with a stop share. This book is available, so worth getting. Ramaswamy's book, it's one of his books, this one on the complete Vinyasa Krama sequences. So this is depicting in much the same way when talking about these kinds of sequence orders according to the planes of movement. So Dasgupta also speaks to categorizing asanas according to the specific planes of movement, whether they be standing or supine or inverted or prone or seated. So these are broad categories. And like I said, you see these broad categories seen in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. In Ramaswamy's presentation, he explains that there's a variety of standing such positions. So the first of which being standing with the feet together, which he calls the Tadasana sequence. Different kinds of movements whilst standing with the feet together, standing on the toes, Tadasana. Samasthiti is the starting point, of course. Spreading the toes wide, like the Charlie Chaplin kind of stance. Different kinds of arm movements, spinal movements. So some of these you don't see in Ashtanga Vinyasa nor in BKS Iyengar's Light on Yoga, but Ramaswamy gives these variations, which there are photographs of Krishnamacharya demonstrating some of these variations. So then we see some examples that we know, Uttanasana or Padahastasana, or like a twisted Uttanasana, or perhaps the Uttanasana in the opposite direction, like we saw in the Yoga Makaranda, or Utkatasana, either the half Utkatasana, Ardha Utkatasana, or the complete Utkatasana, Purna Utkatasana. Different hasta vinyasas, different arm variations. Also the squatting, the full Utkatasana, now Malasana or Kanchyasana, the garland or the golden belt. Also included is Pashasana, the twist whilst in the squat, which is also seen in the Sritattvanidhi and the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. Otherwise, there's the standing whilst having the feet apart, another standing category. If we go to that point in this particular book. So this would be here. So this is broadly known as a triangle sequence. because notably we have the Trikonasana, the triangle pose, also twisted variation, the Parsvakonasana, also standing, bouncing on one leg as such, the Parsvottanasana, either with the hands to the floor or the hands behind the back, also bouncing on one leg, the Virabhadrasana, warrior sequence, which also leads to a standing one leg balance. And all this leading to spread of the feet to Prasaritapadottanasana, which is leading to coming to the floor in Samakonasana. Otherwise, we see the one leg variations in particular, which I'll pull up in just a moment. Here we are. So these are popular amongst the tapasvins, performers of austerities. So this is a famous one, or doing so with the one leg in half lotus, or doing Vatayanasana, the horse pose. Like we saw this pose in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati, or doing a one leg Uttanasana with that opposite leg in half lotus, or doing so with a squat, one leg squat. We've seen that in Hathabhyasa-paddhati. Otherwise, there's one leg Marichasana, standing Marichasana, or this Uttita Hasta Parangushtasana. Otherwise, a repeat of what we saw, the one leg Virabhadrasana, standing balance, Trivikramasana, or standing with one leg behind the head, or doing a backbend while standing on one leg, Natarajasana, which is a nod to this Tandava dance of Lord Shiva. So those are the three groups of standing postures. Otherwise, there's groups of supine postures. Might as well look at that. That's the next one that's depicted here in this book, supine sequence, some of which you'll recognize from the supine postures seen in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. We see remarkably similar positions. And also this backbend that leads to this backbend. And the counterpose is not depicted, but it's inferred whenever this comes up. It likely will have the counterpose, likely this kind of a pose, which is exactly what one sees explicitly described in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. These are such variations we also see in Krishnamacharya's Yoga Makaranda. Otherwise, this is all a supine twist, but this is all essentially leading to the shoulder stand, Sarvangasana, which brings us to various variations, and the plow pose, Halasana, various possibilities, many variations. Otherwise, there's the bow sequence. Again, note the similarities to what we may have seen in the prone posture sequence as depicted in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. So we have Bhujangasana, Shalabhasana, and sort of an advanced Shalabhasana, Dhanurasana, one leg, two legs, turning to one side. Otherwise, let's see. There were those arm balances and inversions that also occurred in that Nubjasana sequence in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati. So if you want to see that really, really quickly, I'll just pull that up in a moment. So that would be here, the inverted posture sequence. So this is where we see Shirshasana and variations, as well as some arm balancing proper, like Pinchamayarasana, Rishikasana, Scorpion pose. Or arm balances, Bakasana, Bhujapidasana, from the headstand, Shirshasana with the tripod base, Ordva Kukutasana, Kaundinyasana, Ashtavakrasana, these kinds of arm balances. Otherwise, if you want to see the seated type postures, we start with the asymmetric variations, which commence here in this book. So there's the lead-in sequence from Samasthiti, like we saw in Yoga Makaranda, coming to sit down, and then after which one can perform any of these asanas. They all have subroutines, like the Marichasana subroutine, bending forward, twisting to one side, doing a counterpose or twisting to the other side. Then the half lotus sequence, bending forward. One can lift up to a side plank, twisting to one side, twisting to the other side, lifting up to Utpluti, or the counter pose, Janarshirshasana or Mahamudra, or the twisted Janarshirshasana, Akarna Dhanurasana, which leads to Ekaparashirshasana, Skandasana, Bhairavasana, Chakrasana. All such variations. Tirang Mukha Ekapara Paschimottanasana, which leads to Crown Chasana. There's a twisted variation here. There's a counter pose. The counter pose is not present in Ashtanga Vinyasa nor in BK Iyengar's presentations, but this appears in the Salutation to the Teacher in the Eternal One. And so there's also pictures of Krishnamacharya demonstrating these kinds of one leg counter pose postures like this. The Matsyendrasana. Otherwise, we can proceed to the posterior stretch, Paschimottanasana. Again, towards the end, it gives you the sequence to come back to standing. Otherwise, coming from standing to come to the floor again, but to do Paschimottanasana, which is symmetrical. Twisted Paschimottanasana, Kurmasana. One can come to side plank as well, from the ground rather than from the dog pose. Counter poses. Also, Navasana, boat pose. Spreading the feet wide is also symmetrical. Upavishtakonasana, different hasta vinyasas, hands forward, hands grabbing the feet, bending to one side, twisting to one side, doing with different hasta vinyasas. And this is leading to Samakonasana, Baddhakonasana as a counter pose. Other such variations, Gomukhasana, Siddhasana, Padmasana, Simhasana. Otherwise, there's the other two seated varieties, the Vajrasana varieties, Padmasana varieties. So if we fast forward to that, here's the lotus varieties. It shows the half lotus, but also the full lotus and variations. Baddha Padmasana here, Utpluti, counterpose to the Yoga Mudra Asana. Or in the shoulder stand. Kukutasana, Garbhapindasana, Uttana Kurmasana, Matsyasana, otherwise known as Supta Padmasana. We saw Matsyasana fish pose here in any case. Otherwise, the Padmasana whilst doing Mayurasana. Or Urdhva Kukutasana, arm balance, or in the headstand, Shirshasana, or in Pinchamayurasana, and then the return to standing. Otherwise, there's the Vajrasana sequence. Here it is. So getting to Vajrasana. Different variations, which there's some resemblance to some positions seen in the Hathabhyasa-paddhati, otherwise it's a counter pose. And also proceeding to Ushtrasana, camel pose, and Kapotasana, pigeon pose. Also one leg camel pose and pigeon pose, the Virasana, hero pose, lying back, lion pose as well. Otherwise, there's a kind of a miscellaneous group, which is unique, Vishesha sequence. This is where you can see that there's Surya Namaskara because it doesn't really fit in the other categories. Otherwise, the side plank sequence, Vasishtasana, the Anjaneyasana, Hanumanasana type sequences. So they're a little more miscellaneous. Or this rolling vinyasa, which is going between halasana and paschimottanasana, even to this backbend from the shoulder stand, uttana mayurasana, upward facing peacock. So these are more miscellaneous in nature, jumping to such arm balances rather than from the headstand. Mayurasana proper. The Ding Namaskar, another type of salutation to the various directions. There's the flying bird sequence, Khagasana. And then this book also depicts some pranayama techniques. Technique for Pratyahara, Shanmukhi Mudra. In any case, this is Ramaswamy's book, which is quite an extensive scope. And I'll conclude with this. So I thank you for following my train of thought in terms of exploring what Krishnamacharya taught and where he was coming from. And I hope you enjoyed, and I'll talk to you the next time.